So I had to learn to deal with the bully. And I learned you knock the bully down. The bully was really chicken. When I came into the world, I was the 11th child. And in a very quick time, by the time I was 2, my father was killed in an automobile accident. So my mother was left with 11 children. I don't know how I understood, but from the beginning, I decided that my mother needed protection. I was going to lift the family. I was the youngest, I was the smallest, but I was going to lift them. I was tired of the oppression, tired of losing. I just took it that we were going to win.
You know, Jack used to be a priest. And I never thought I'd have common cause with a member of the priesthood after my education.
And with that, he swings at me, and I see the fist coming. So I turn my head and let him hit the back of my head, which didn't hurt. And I thought, okay, I'll let this go, because I'm not here to get in a fight, you know, and all that. And then he said to me, well, what do you think of that? So I let him know what I thought. I punched him and knocked him up over the bed, and blood jumping out of his nose. And I ended up within 10 minutes in the seminary in front of the rector. I was about 14 years old. My brother's front teeth were knocked out by the mob. And my mother came to me and said, Jackie, I don't have $300 for your brother's teeth. I want you to go get that for me. So I went up to see this big old Irish cop at the police station. He didn't like me. And he said, get out of here, you little shit. You need the smartest lawyer in the city of Pittsburgh. The streetcar took me back through Pittsburgh, and I jumped off the streetcar at a jail, figuring there'd be lawyers around there. And I asked everybody around that jail, who was the smartest lawyer in the city of Pittsburgh? And they all said the same name. His name is Charlie Maloney. I went and got Charlie Maloney to defend my brother. We walked into the court. Judge said, Charlie, what are you doing here? This is a small claims court, you know. And he started yelling, we're here to win. And before anything happened, the mob counted out $300 and gave us $300 and we left with our money. What I realized was I didn't have any power, I didn't have any money. I was just a little kid, I was 14 years old. But I recruited the best lawyer in the city of Pittsburgh, and we won. And that really becomes the story of my life. Without power, without money, you can do a lot. I think when you try to pull off big things, the first thing you got to get a hold of is your inner self and your own strength and your own power. And I think so many people forget that. They reach to other people or other institutions. They forget that the real strength is within.
This little guy is speaking with incredible authority and passion and honesty. And it ceased to be an abstract concept, you know, that people were being imprisoned wrongfully in the world or tortured, and it became very real. He met these people.
There's a difference between those who count the lash and those who receive the lash. I've never tried to present myself as someone who's received the lash. They're the real heroes of the human rights movement.
I think he's one of those products of the 60s, I suppose, of that activism, you know, that sense that, hey, it's our world, we're gonna fix it. You know?
1962, I was in the seminary at Catholic University. And Dr. King had started his organizing in Washington, D.C. And they would come to our seminaries and recruit us to join in the effort of equality. And we happily joined. And eventually that 62 effort turned into the March on Washington. That was where Dr. King gave the great speech, I Have a Dream. We were part organizers of that. Not great, we weren't very important, but we were part of it. And we'd go door to door, try to get people to go to it, you know, spread the word, all that. And so I was there for that speech. I was, if you're looking at Dr. King from his back, I was 11 o'clock to the left, about 300 yards back. There's a whole mess of seminarians in there, I'm one of them. When we walked back, all of us talked about how powerful that was and how we had a lot to do and how we had to go out and support Dr. King and move the motion forward, because it was so emotionally moving. I don't even know how to explain it. You felt you were at a historical moment. It electrified the feelings from my mom, from the history of St. Francis and the peace movement, and all my instincts of that would take me back to the coal miners or the steel mills, my mom, to my training in the seminary, the great part of nonviolence. It sealed it. It was like, that's what you got to do. And I wanted to continue fighting for justice. Where was that? Well, that's apartheid. Let's go knock that down. Fine. Let's go. Lesotho represented both the opportunity to work with young Americans living in the third world, and they did a great job. On the other hand, it also was my entry into the struggle against apartheid, which to my mind was a continuation of the civil rights struggle in the United States, and Dr. King now became Mandela for me. No different. I was going to march to that drum now.
When I first heard him speak about his advocacy, about amnesty, about torture victims with such evangelical passion, it galvanized me and everybody else on that tour, that conspiracy of hope tour, you know.
I wanted the United States, the American people, first to understand what amnesty did, and that within that context that they could actually join and do something about human rights. And at that time, I was writing a letter. I thought, if you can get someone out of jail, you can stop the torture, and you can write a letter, you got to morally do that. Bono walked over, and so I stood up, and I sort of insulted him. I said, are you really Irish? You know, and he had, like, because I'm plastic Irish. I'm like American Irish. He's real Irish, right? And it shocked him like that. It was a little bit of an insult. I wanted to get his attention. So I did, and he said, what do you want? And I said, I need your band anywhere in the world for 2 weeks. Okay. I'm in a meeting, a world meeting of Amnesty, and the head of the Chilean section asked me, would you produce a show now that we're independent, it's coming, would you come and do a show, you know, inside Chile? I said, yeah, we have to rebaptize that stadium to give it back to the people, because that's where they put everybody, and that, if your name was called out, Gomez, boom, there'd be a gun go off, Gomez was gone. In the room with the general, there were bazookas and machine guns and grenades and all kind of weaponry. And I told him, I said, you tell this general if he does this one more time, he blows any more tear gas on us and try to cause me a riot, that he blames this on us, that I'm going to shut this show down and embarrass Chile in front of the whole world. And Ariel said, we can't talk to them that way, Jack. They're, you know, these are beasts. These are terrible people, you know. I said, Ariel, if you don't tell them, I will make this even more clear than I'm feeling right now. Okay, Jack, and he did them. And I literally saw the blood go up in this general's face when he told him. The blood literally went up in that guy's face. And I realized, this is the first time in 16 years this guy had to listen to another citizen in the world. They never had to listen to citizens in 16 years. And this guy is looking at me. I felt like a hero between him and me. Yes, I felt like a hero that day. Yeah. And I let him know, and I won. I backed him down.
And I met the mothers, and we brought them out on stage. And in the very stadium that their sons and fathers had been tortured and killed. And probably the most emotional performance of certainly my life. You know, dwarfed by the magnitude of what had happened to them, their loss, their sense of injustice. And yet there was a healing.
The mothers disappeared, came out in the middle of sing song, they dance alone. The whole stadium was crying, 100,000 people were crying. Civil liberties and human rights is one and the same, and we're pushing back the indecent. That's the way I see it. That's the force of what I think Dr. King, Mandela, Aung San Suu Kyi, all the great people of the world who struggle for these kind of rights and are well known for it. That's what they're pushing back, is the indecent.
You know, a voice like Jack's is increasingly important. We can't let this slide, you know. We become medieval. We need to evolve. Torture's a real barometer of how civilized a society is.
All you need to bring to a cause, a belief, is creativity. You really, in a certain way, I'm afraid of money and power, as it might dull my senses. I like the idea that I operate without power or money and go and try and get it done anyway. And I think, I'm hoping my life proves that. Justice is the same at 14 as it is at 70. Get into the battle at 14. Get into the battle at 8. Get into it.